Now, in this section, I'm going to be talking to MAN Energy Systems, and I'm going to be talking to two fuel cell makers, Techo 2030 and PowerCell, as well as Hexagon Purus, a company that is developing or shaped out of Hexagon composites and is helping with the integration process. So with me for this session, just to talk about the technologies here, we've got Gunnar Stage from MAN Energy Solutions calling in on a link. We've got Richard Berkling, CEO of PowerCell in Sweden. Like me in Sweden, still not allowed. He's closer than me to Norway, I think, but he's still not allowed over the border. And And Morten Holm from Hexagon Purus, which is recently split from Hexagon. And he's going to talk to us a little bit about the integration aspects of this. So greetings to the three of you, remotely or not. Well, we all are remotely, even though one of them is in the proper studio. Gunnar, I want to start with you, if I may, because you are the resident technology to some extent. MAN has engines in a lot of ships. They're the great big, huge cathedral engines, as they used to be known, that are seen in some of the biggest of ships down to the smaller engines. And I've spoken to MAN on a couple of occasions about the transformation and the tests that you've been doing, for example, in Copenhagen to develop an ammonia engine. And I know you're developing other engines as well for this breadth of fuels that might be possible. So I wanted to talk to you about where you are, because without you doing this transformation, shipping can't do this transformation. If there are no engines, then we know that Andre will not be able to have his engines to put onto the ships that he wants with Viridis bulk carriers, for example. So can you give me a little bit of an intro here about where you are? And I know you've got one little picture that you want to share here, and I think this does very well explain the breadth of the challenge that you as an engine maker are facing.
Yes, certainly. So first of all, I would like to state that we clearly see the international shipping, the deep sea shipping, and then simplifying this a bit, maybe each vessel that does not call its home port on a daily basis. There we see and we expect that we need to prepare for a multi-fuel scenario and a multi-fuel future. This will not be the same for all applications, for all vessels, for all trade routes. Typically, there's a trade-off. The fuels most affordable to produce, for example, hydrogen, are then on the other hand side most difficult and most expensive to store and handle, and the other way around. And therefore, the optimum fuel will very much depend on the vessel. And for that reason, fuel flexibility is really the key. And that in two aspects. The first aspect is we will need at least dual fuel capability to make sure a vessel calling a different port, maybe on a different continent, will always have the opportunity of a secure backup fuel. But then also the other aspect is the easy retrofittability, because you cannot, even if you are able to identify the optimum fuel for your application today, you cannot be sure that this will still be the optimum in 10 or 20 years from now. And maybe you want to also sell your vessel after a couple of years, maybe to a different continent, and then also to safeguard investments, there needs to be a simple retrofit capability. So stating this, flexibility is key. What fuels do we see and do we prepare for? Today, already available, of course, natural gas, and in the long term, carbon neutral synthetic methane, methanol, LPG are available today. And then as the carbon free fuels of the mid to longer term future, that is clearly then ammonia and hydrogen. Ammonia probably more for the deep sea long range shipping, whereas hydrogen would be more attractive to more short sea point to point shipping, because the handling there of the fuel, the energy density is much more complex. To give a timeline, the ammonia engine we have announced will be available in 2024, that is 3 years from now. For the hydrogen engine, we expect to see the first pilot applications, let's say, about around year 2025. And then probably a larger pickup in the market somewhat later, also depending on the availability of the fuel.
Do you anticipate that it'll be retrofits, both for the hydrogen markets with your engine suitable for hydrogen and retrofits for ammonia? Or do you think it's going to be more of a new building pickup?
Well, I think it needs to be both. If you see the long lifetime of the vessels, 25 to 30 years, then I don't think we and the industry have time to only rely on new buildings. There will, in addition to the new buildings, retrofits will be needed to safeguard and future-proof today's investments. As I explained before, if you invest in a vessel today, you want to make sure that you can still operate it in 20, 25 years from now.
With the hydrogen four-stroke engines, do you see them being retrofitted on a vessel to replace existing auxiliary power systems, auxiliary engines, and then a vessel having additional hydrogen tanks installed, for example, while it still has an ordinary fuel system for a fossil fuel, for example? Because I have heard that some larger vessels, the auxiliary engines can be up to 25% of the emissions of the vessel.
Yes, and of course the retrofit is a serious task to be considered, and this will have a cost for sure, not only on the vessel, on the engine. In some cases, the engine may actually be the smaller part, but the fuel supply system, the tank system on the vessel will be the more challenging part. And therefore, it will make a lot of sense to go, if you invest in a vessel now, to go for fuel-ready, fuel-prepared solutions that allow for a relatively easy retrofit later on. And that is what we are working on and what we will deliver in short time from now to offer exactly that fuel readiness. So even if there's no hydrogen yet today, the engine is and the system is prepared as well as possible for the future use.
Good. Thank you very much, Gunnar. Of course, one of the other alternatives for auxiliary engines and for smaller vessels is the application of fuel cells. There are, as we heard briefly before, a number of projects that are developing worldwide. We heard on some of the international power play statements, projects looking at the use of fuel cells because of their application. Two companies are taking part with our discussions today, and that's PowerCell and Techo 2030. Let me start with Techo 2030. Stian Arkre is in the studio, joining us in the studio. Stian, from your perspective, you've got plans to build a mega gigawatt factory in northern Norway. You must be very confident about what the market is for you, for your product. Can you tell me a little bit about what sort of an appetite you think there is for your products? And of course, you've got one of your competitors here joining us, PowerCell. You've got Richard Berkling here. The two of you surely are going to be competing in the same market. And I'm going to be asking the question here from Richard in terms of how he sees himself positioning PowerCell in the maritime market. Stian, from your perspective, what position is Techo 2030 going to be taking in the fuel cell market, and how do you see that expanding if you've got to build a factory before you can actually start selling into the shipping industry?
Well, thank you, Craig. I think there will be a huge appetite. I think it's very pleasant to see Jarand Rystad earlier today saying that hydrogen is going to be a major fuel for shipping in the years towards 2050. So that aligns very well with a lot of other predictions that we see, and we are, to correct you slightly, Craig, we are not building the factory first and then developing the fuel cells. We are doing that simultaneously as we see that that the demand is growing and it needs to be filled. So hence our let's say doubled the effort with the factory, starting serial production in a fairly small scale in 2023. And then our current development of a dedicated marine fuel cell. So I think it's clear that let's say that the market will have a huge appetite for hydrogen in the years to come. I think it's very nice to meet Rickard here, although on camera, but still there will be room for both of us, I'm sure, when it comes to the market segment. And let me just add also that Gunnar was quite correctly emphasizing the need for fuel flexibility. I just wanted to add also, it's very important to keep in mind that you can have very flexible solutions on board the same ship. So there are many ways to utilize hydrogen or other new technologies. So in combination with fossil fuel and conventional technology. And if I may take this opportunity, we are releasing interesting news on that topic at 1 o'clock today, so please stop by Tico 2030 on our
social media. Do you envisage that you'll be able to supply fuel cells that are flexible fuel cells?
Sorry, say again, Craig.
Are you talking here about flexible fuel in your fuel cells?
No, we are talking flexible technologies on the same ship in order to meet different requirements from different sailing areas.
Okay. Rickard, can I turn to you now, please, from PowerCell? I know about PowerCell quite well. We're both in Sweden, so of course I've been following PowerCell. You're a company that evolved from Volvo. Oddly enough, about in 2008, I think it was, you evolved from Volvo and have now listed in Stockholm and doing quite well. But you're not predominantly focused on the maritime industry. I'll say it's quite recently that you've become more focused in the maritime sector. And it was, you had a joint venture, you still have a joint venture, I think, with Hexagon and Nel in Norway, looking at the maritime applications. What made you start to focus on the shipping industry? Why did you think that it was an attractive industry for your products?
Well, thank you for hosting this and inviting us. I think that Gunnar stated this analysis very well about the flexibility that is necessary, because in a technology shift that we are experiencing affecting also the maritime industry, we cannot wait until the perfect solution is available. We need to start supporting the traditional technology and doing the replacement in the transition phase. So I fully agree with the flexibility aspect. And I think one reason why we approach the maritime segment as one of our prioritized segments is that we have a product portfolio that is ready to be offered and served to the market. That means that we can participate in this transition and create the flexibility where you combine new technology with the existing combustion engine and that solution. So for us, we view maritime industry as being leader in this transition in society. Of course, we are active in other segments as well. But I think it's important to state that we need to start making this transition today. And having available products and solutions means that we need to be participating in experiencing, okay, what is this technology going to affect the operation? How are you going to make sure that the new technology is not just a cost punishment for the operators? We need to participate in that development of a value chain, of a big new business model. And I think that the maritime industry is leading this in a large extent. And our offering is well prepared for the characteristics of the marine operators. With that said, I also agree with Techco 2030. We can say that we're competitors, but we need every good contribution to this transition is necessary, because it is a massive undertaking and we have room for everybody and we will be complementing. And we have, as you stated, a collaboration with Hexagon Hexagon is a really strong contributing partner in all of our segments. So what I want to push today is the fact that we can start doing this today. We don't need to wait until 2025 or 27. I think it's important to have operators, companies like ourselves, pioneering into this transition.
I know that you are active in a number of projects already, and I've seen also the Steen Techo 2030 is in fact active in a number of projects as well. But before I start talking to Morten Holm from Hexagon, I've just got another question about the technology, because I see also a number of projects that are starting up looking at solid oxide fuel cells as well, and both PowerCell and Techo 2030 are focusing on PEM fuel cells, proton exchange membrane fuel cells, two different technologies with two different sets of challenges. But I've heard, and correct me if I'm wrong, I've heard that solid oxide fuel cells will have a much more power possibility from them, although operating at a much higher temperature. Do you see solid oxide fuel cells, if they evolve for the maritime industry, as being a competition for PEM fuel cells, or do you see them slightly different markets? Will a solid oxide fuel cell be more applicable for a deep sea vessel, therefore competing perhaps with a Man Energy Solutions four-stroke engine that's being used as an auxiliary engine, or do you see it more competing in the short sea sector? Perhaps I could go to, I'll start with Rickard here, please, because I know you're the more sort of established product, and then I'll get Steen's response.
Well, I think your analysis is quite good, but the jury is still out. We don't fully understand and know exactly where different technologies or solutions will be applicable. What we know is that we need to have a technology that is future-proof. That means that we need to support different fuel sources, we need to support different solutions, and then we need to be supporting the industry where we go. It would be easy for me to state that, yes, we can replace a traditional four-stroke engine, but I think it's premature to do that. I think we are onto a solution that can be done in that way, but we haven't validated it yet in a business case, because one thing that we have against us is we don't know the life cycle of this technology fully yet. We haven't been out there for 25, 30 years, that the current technology is. So I think that your analysis is spot on, but the jury is still out on exactly how this will evolve.
Steen, can you just give your response as well, just in a couple of seconds, because I really want to talk to Hexagon before we run out of time.
I will be very quick, because I think you fairly well answered your own question, Craig. We see that solid oxide fuel cell is probably going to be more an alternative for deep sea shipping, both when it comes to efficiency operation, but also that it can work with several different fuels.
Great, thank you. Morten, let's turn to now to the whole integration. Just for the end of this session, I just want to turn to the integration of the technologies, because Hexagon Purus is a sort of breakaway listed part of Hexagon recently, and you're focusing very much on the maritime sector. What sort of experience have you already got in the maritime sector? And then talk me through some of the integration issues, because it's one thing to have a fuel cell and then to have the fuel, but how do you bring them all together in a way that we've not seen yet explicitly in the industry? So first of all, let's talk a little bit about the experience that you've got within Hexagon Purus and integrating systems.
Yeah, thank you, Craig. I mean, it is all about making a complete solution work. And in Hexagon, we've been working on the energy transition and on hydrogen for a number of years, and then focusing first on the storage and then on the overall fuel system. So you need storage at the key, either in some sort of ground storage facility or containerized solution. And then you need to bring the fuel onto the ship, and you need storage, hydrogen storage, on board the ship, either integrated storage or maybe even swappable containerized storage on board the ship. And then you need to bring the fuel onto the forward to the fuel cell.
And let's just bring up that image. Can I just bring up that image of the Golden Gate Bridge? I think the vessel that you've been involved in recently, and perhaps that could just work as an example here. This is one of the vessels I believe you've been working on, is that right?
Yeah, exactly. And this is a fast ferry that's operating in the, or that will be operating in the San Francisco Bay, which has just actually been put on the water. And you know, hydrogen is a very compressed hydrogen is a very good fuel for the short sea type applications. And so, and these are technologies that we know quite well. It's not something that is newly invented. I mean, we've been putting fuel storage and fuel systems on board many different mobility applications for years, whether that's heavy-duty trucks or trains or buses. So we know this technology quite well and how it's how it needs to come together all the way from the filling and the storage onto the fuel cell. And now we're taking...
Look at that integration image now,
yeah.
By the way. Can we just bring up that integration image? Because I think this probably illustrates this. It's a graphic that perhaps we can show.
Yeah, it's a simple animation that basically shows the storage on the quay in the port, and then how you bring the fuel on board from the fill panel on board to the vessel, and then the different storage solutions that that you have on board, and then bringing it further on to the fuel cell. But I think the point I want to make
is... The different fuels. Can I just interrupt there? Because I just wanted to ask a question about the different fuel types.
Yep.
That might be, because we're talking about compressed, we're talking about liquefied, and we're talking about and then to hydrogen there, and we're talking also about ammonia, and we may be talking about other fuels for fuel cells in the future. Does it differ greatly depending on the fuel?
There, as we've heard here all through today, there will be many types of fuels in the future, because each of them have strengths and each of them have some sort of drawbacks connected to them. So, but we do see that our strength, particularly in compressed hydrogen and how that can be utilized, we see that that's a very viable fuel for the short sea applications, you know, passenger ferries, car ferries, fast ferries, inland waterways, and so forth. So it's not, again, it's not new technology. It's technology that we know very well and that we use for other mobility applications, and now we're adapting it to the maritime environment.
Have you got any idea when you see there'll be a breakthrough for you in terms of what year would you say will be when you can turn around to your stakeholders, to your shareholders, and say, okay, we're now winning, we're now actually making so much money, this is fantastic. When's going to be the, you know, the killer year for Hexagon Purus?
Yeah, I wish I could say that it's very soon, but I think you have the story on LNG, right? It took somewhat 15 years from the first LNG application until you were up to 40, 50 ships, right? So we need to do that faster. So we're kind of in a hurry as a society. Progress can't wait. We need to move faster. But it's going to take some time. You need to get some vessels onto normal use, and then once you have the demo vessels and you get the technology proven in that application, it will start to move. There's so much momentum behind this now, so hopefully we can say that maybe second half of the decade you will start to see a lot more hydrogen-powered vessels.
Great. Thank you very much for that. Good. Thank you very much for that, for Morten. I'm afraid we're running out of time here now, and I need to move on to our next panel as we start to look at infrastructure. So can I say thank you to our four guests, two on a call and two in the studio there, talking to me about the technology and the building of the systems for that. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for your time, and I do appreciate it. And I do appreciate it. It's been very short as well. Thank you.
Tough enough to be on a spacecraft. Light enough to be in vehicles. Some call us pioneers or enablers. Our composites technology is at the heart of what we do. And we do it with passion. Because we believe that clean air is a right, not a privilege.
The maritime industry is facing new challenges. The time to act is now. Hydrogen from renewable energy, combined with our fuel cells, will support you decarbonizing your vessels without compromising the performance. Our marine fuel cell system is developed to meet the highest marine safety standards. And most importantly, we can provide you with megawatt fuel cell solutions today. With us as a partner, your vessels will have high performance, efficiency, and safe operations with true zero emission. It's time to move to a sustainable shipping. Join the next big wave today.